He's the biggest loser. Pete Thomas shares how he dropped more than 180 pounds and how he kept it off after the cameras stopped rolling.
Well, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this edition of the 700 Club. I guess the liberal pundits are shell-shocked at the performance of their champion last night in that debate. Governor Romney cleaned his clock, as the saying goes, and it was everybody's jumping on the president, but that's debate number one. It's like the first quarter.
There is more to come, certainly. Well, people are saying that Romney went on the offensive against the president and that Obama did a poor job of making his case. David Brody has this look at the debate and where the race goes from here.
The debate here in Denver turned quickly from smiles and handshakes to a passionate and aggressive Mitt Romney, laying out the case that the last 4 years under President Obama have been a major failure.
When the president took office, 32 million people on food stamps, 47 million on food stamps today, economic growth this year slower than last year, and last year slower than the year before. Going forward with the status quo is not going to cut it for the American people who are struggling today.
The president seemed on the defensive all night, but did keep saying that Romney's tax plan calls for a $5 trillion tax cut that favors the wealthy. Romney's reply, not so.
I'm not looking for a $5 trillion tax cut. What I've said is I won't put in place a tax cut that adds to the deficit.
Well, for 18 months he's been running on this tax plan. And now, 5 weeks before the election, he's saying that his big, bold idea is never mind.
On the huge federal deficits the last 4 years, Romney didn't let up, saying that under the president, trillions have been added to the national debt.
I think it's not just an economic issue. I think it's a moral issue. I think it's frankly not moral for my generation to keep spending massively more than we take in, knowing those burdens are going to be passed on to the next generation. And they're going to be paying the interest and the principal all their lives.
The president blamed the deficits on the economic mess he inherited.
When I walked into the Oval Office, I had more than a $1 trillion deficit greeting me. And we know where it came from. Two wars that were paid for on a credit card, two tax cuts that were not paid for, and a whole bunch of programs that were not paid for, and then a massive economic crisis.
Then there was the debate over Obamacare. Romney picked the new health care law apart on a number of levels and said one major problem was how the president rammed it through Congress.
Entirely on a partisan basis, instead of bringing America together and having a discussion on this important topic, you pushed through something that you and Nancy Pelosi and Harry Reid thought was the best answer.
This was a bipartisan idea. In fact, it was a Republican idea. And Governor Romney, at the beginning of this debate, wrote and said, what we did in Massachusetts could be a model for the nation.
All of the topics had one main theme running throughout them, what the role of the federal government should be. That provided the biggest contrast of all, with Romney arguing for a limited approach and the president making the case for a larger role.
We want to give these gateways of opportunity for all Americans, because if all Americans are getting opportunity, we're all going to be better off.
Look behind us, the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence. The role of government is to promote and protect the principles.
With debate number one wrapped up, the attention now turns to the campaign trail. The president will be in Colorado on Thursday. Colorado is a state that Mitt Romney has a slight lead in. And Mitt Romney will be in Virginia, where the president has a slight lead. Time now of the essence, as early voting has started in more than half the states. David Brody, CBN News, in Denver, Colorado.
Thanks, David. You can always get David's latest political reports on the Brody File on CBNNews.com, and you can watch the Brody File TV show on Fridays at 9:30 a.m. on the ABC Family Channel. Terry, I was very impressed with Mitt's performance. The thing that came through to me, though, is that his handlers had said, look, tone it down. Don't go after any major thrust. He was given a softball question by Jim Lehrer, the moderator. Tell us about government regulations. Well, the Chamber of Commerce has identified right now 200 major pieces of regulation that are in the wings in the federal agencies, in addition to what they've already put in place. And businesses are being regulated to death. Romney, instead of answering that question, said, well, I think we should have regulation. Well, of course, if you're going to play a football game, you need to know what the rules are. You need to have referees that know how to call the, you know, downs and the balls and all that. He ducked it. But does that mean that as he governs, he's going to be as equally moderate, or is that his nature, or is it not? So I think we're not going to see a robust Ronald Reagan, but we are going to see an extraordinarily intelligent, honorable man take over the reins. And it just seems like this was the step he needed to break through the miasma that's been caused by all of the false advertising that Obama has put on the airwaves. And the people are now saying, yes, we believe he's the man, and I think all he takes a couple of percentage points and you're over the top.
His experience and business background really came through last night, and I think, you know, everybody says the number one topic on everyone's mind is jobs, and
well,
he seems to know how to make it happen. He laid it on the line.
He knows how to create jobs. Mm-hmm. Obama's never created a job in his life. He doesn't have any experience, and so, but it's amazing how his liberal allies have said, was he sleepwalking? What's the deal? So there'll be another one, and he can recover and maybe come back much stronger, but next time's going to be on foreign policy, and I think Obama is quite vulnerable in this area as well, but Mitt's got to be careful that he doesn't start talking about bashing China. Big, big mistake. And you've got to be careful you don't look like we're going to start another war. And so, you know, that's what they did to Goldwater. They had him, you remember the little child with the,
yeah.
You know, she loves me, he loves me, and I'd boom and blow them up,
yeah.
You know. So
yeah.
He's got to, you know, he wants to avoid that mantra. But if things continue to go as they are, the polls are in his favor, the momentum is in his favor, and this debate did it for him, and so we'll see what happens. Well, regardless of who wins this election, politicians in Washington will have to make some very, very tough decisions on taxes and spending by the end of this year. Lee Webb has that story from the CBN newsroom. Here's Lee.
Pat, members of Congress are working on legislation now to avoid a budget crisis. The New York Times reports senators are pursuing several options legislatively to keep massive tax hikes and government spending cuts from happening early next year. John Waage has more on the impact of what some are calling Taxmageddon.
A tax hike is headed America's way on January 1st. One so steep, some congressional aides are calling it Taxmageddon.
It's $500 billion of higher taxes just in 2013 alone.
Curtis Dubay is with the Heritage Foundation.
A tax hike of that size for just 1 year is simply unprecedented. It's going to take an enormous chunk of the economy out of the hands of the businesses and peoples and family that earn the income and give it to Congress to spend.
Not only will the Bush-era tax cuts end, but much more. The Social Security payroll tax will jump from 4.2% to 6.2% of employee pay. The child exemption will drop from $1,000 to $500 per child. The repair of the marriage penalty will disappear, meaning many married couples will suddenly have to pay more taxes. Middle-income Americans will be treated like they're rich in the eyes of the IRS and taxed much more.
70% directly falls on middle and low-income taxpayers.
But not everyone sees hiking taxes next year as a bad thing, especially if it hits the rich.
Raising taxes in the short term and spending it, particularly taxes on the top end, will produce more jobs. We have a lot of corporations and a lot of very wealthy people sitting on their money.
But Dubay says it's the threat of such tax hikes that keeps businesses from investing.
There's so much uncertainty. They don't know if they can add new workers. They don't know whether they should make a new investment. So they're holding back and waiting.
Borisage worries that without new tax revenues, massive spending cuts would devastate public schools, public works, Pell Grants for college kids, and more.
Food stamps and Medicare and aid for the most vulnerable, seniors, people at the end of their life. We're too rich a society to make those kinds of cuts.
Congress and the president together could stop Taxmageddon, but with the stakes so high on November 6th, nothing is likely to happen before then. John Waggie, CBN News.
Pat, the real question is, do we have politicians in Washington with a political backbone to do the right thing?
Lee, you see how they demagogue when anybody begins to say anything about regulating the flow of spending. Immediately, the ads hit the airways. They want to take away, you know, the lights on the Washington Monument. You know, it goes on and on. They'll take your school lunches away. The poor little kids are going to starve. You're not going to have any teachers. It just goes on and on and on. And that's the liberal thing. And so people say, why should we step into that vortex? It's got to be bipartisan agreement. The president had a commission, Simpson Bowles, Bowles Simpson, whichever, and it was given to him in a bipartisan, one is a Democrat, one's a Republican, brilliant plan. He ignored it. The president has not submitted but one budget. The budget was overwhelmingly, I think it was 97%, voted down by the Democrat-controlled Congress. They said, this is ridiculous. We can't even consider it. So the Senate has not passed the budget in the last 3 years. No budget, no budget to run the government on. And they don't want to take a stand on anything. And the partisanship is so rancorous in Washington that they can't get together. There's got to be some spirit of civility and something of putting the nation first, and we don't have it. All we have is personal party interest. And I don't know what to say except coming out of this election, if one party wins a decisive victory, maybe we can have a change. But unless that's, we're in for a really rough patch as a nation, because a house divided against itself cannot stand. That's what the Bible says, and it's true. It's a great truth. A kingdom divided against itself cannot endure. Lee?
Pat, Iranian riot police have been deployed at key intersections in the capital city of Tehran. That move comes after police clashed with protesters angry over the Iranian economy. The country's currency plunged by more than a third in less than a week, and that free fall has sent prices sharply higher. Many low-income Iranians can no longer afford some important food items like chicken and lamb. Many street merchants closed their shops Wednesday, and authorities are trying to clamp down on black market money exchangers. Many analysts blame the currency crisis on the sanctions against Iran's nuclear program. Infighting is also reported among Iranian politicians. Some say poor government policies have made the crisis work. Maybe there's a peaceful way internally of dealing with Iran after all, Pat.
Lee, I've been saying this for some time. I think there are many Iranians who are wonderful people. They love America. They love God. They're good people. And they hate the mullahs. And the mullahs have put in a regime that is not going to work. Now, what do you do about it? That's why beginning a war would be counterproductive, because that would mobilize the dissident people in favor of their government because of the war. The labor unions would strike, go on a prolonged strike, and move to overthrow the government. The college students would begin to strike and overthrow the government. If there was a concerted effort to mobilize the dissidents, that whole country could see a regime change. But you know, when they had a chance after the last election, and there were people in the streets, and there was a real movement to do that, what did our president do? Nothing, absolutely nothing. But now's a chance, and that is why I have not been in favor of a bombing campaign in relation to their nuclear facility, because it would be far, far better to see a peaceful or even a violent overthrow of their government and a regime change. Lee?
The president of Chick-fil-A has voiced his support for biblical families. He's speaking out again. Some liberals criticized Dan Cathy this summer when he said the fast food chain is guilty as charged for supporting pro-family groups that oppose same-sex marriage. In an interview with Atlanta television station WXIA, Cathy said families are very important to our country. They're important to all of us who are concerned about being able to hang on to our heritage. We support biblical families who have always been part of that. The number of severely obese American adults has skyrocketed in the last decade. Researchers from Rand Corporation found 6.6% of adults were 100 pounds or more overweight, up from 3.9% in 2000. Now, that's nearly a 70% increase in just 10 years. More than 15 million people are now classified as severely obese. Researchers point out this level of obesity often affects quality of life and leads to other medical conditions. For example, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, and certain types of cancers are linked to obesity. 70% increase in 10 years, Pat. It's amazing.
It's horrible, but you know, the food we eat, I don't eat fast food. Do you eat that stuff? I mean, every so often. I mean, I love my
Chick-fil-A.
Hamburger.
Huh?
Oh, Chick-fil-A. Yay, we've got us aboard. Yeah.
Well, you know, I do think that it's interesting that that statistic is what it is, because there's so much more information out today about how to eat healthy, and I think a lot of manufacturers are trying to give us things that meet
they
that
are.
Standard.
Well, you've got to read the labels. They're loaded with sugar. When you see high fructose corn syrup, when you see all those other names for sugar that are put in almost everything, and that sets up a craving. And the fast food manufacturers know exactly what they're doing. They used to call certain snacks, they called them beer snacks, because they were loaded with salt and made people thirsty and made them want to eat the pretzels and then drink a beer. I mean, it was deliberate.
Yes.
You know?
Well, we've had lots of experts on this program who've talked about the deliberate move to that end.
But this is terrible. I mean, not only are we getting bloated with finances, we've got a bloated debt, bloated fat people. It just shows that we have lost our sense of self-control in a nation, because where there is no knowledge of God, the people run amok. Well, the Bible says when there's no vision, but it means a vision of God. Mm-hmm. When there's no revelation of God, the people run amok. And we don't have that sense of self-restraint that would attach to a healthy society. And it's a shame. But we're going to introduce you to a man who beat the odds and won the Biggest Loser. It's a fantastic story, and Terry is going to tell us about it.
Well, that is coming up, but also this feature. He may have lost his leg in a war, but that has not stopped him from running for hope. We want you to hear his story, and that's coming up next.
You know, I've been watching the buying power of the U.S. dollar decline for over 40 years now, and that's proof enough for me. Everybody needs some wealth insurance, just as we need life, health, home, auto insurance. And this year brings back memories of 1979 all over again. An oil crisis, sky-high gas, food, gold prices too, but gold is trustworthy. The folks at Swiss America, where I buy my gold, call it private wealth insurance, because gold protects your wealth and privacy, even if the cost of living spins out of control. Gold is the best wealth insurance policy on earth, and you can trust Swiss America. I do, and have for nearly two decades now. Why don't you get Swiss America's free wealth insurance DVD today? You'll be glad you did. And you can tell them Pat Boone told you to call.
Well, welcome back the day after the debate, and people are still in the debate mode. You know, Terry, I used to drive around when I was in college. I sowed my share of oats, wild oats, lots and lots of them. And as I drove around the hills of the Shenandoah Valley, there were these billboards. Prepare to meet your God. I mean, great, big one. And you look at that, you know, I ain't
better
ready.
Better get my act together.
Yeah, 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 here, get rid of that, you know, beer. If you were to die, would you be ready to face God? Prepare to meet your God. Well, that question became very real to a soldier in Lebanon when a landmine exploded under his feet. During a war, Gary Lane shows us his life was transformed and what he's doing with it today.
Lebanese-American Eli Hasbani never dreamed he'd live in Milwaukee, and he never imagined he'd be running a marathon.
My main inspiration is Jesus. That's why I'm doing this, because of him and because he changed my life.
His life journey began half a world away in Lebanon.
It's a beautiful country. It's mentioned in the Bible many times. And the cedar of Lebanon, gorgeous. And this country is really in my heart.
Raised in a Christian culture, he grew up peacefully with his Muslim neighbors.
These people, they were the children were my best friend. We just love to be together and have fun.
Some were Palestinian, not Lebanese.
Palestinians came to our country as refugees. We hosted them, we liked them, we sympathized with them, and now they turn against us and they want to kill us.
Civil war broke out in 1975 when the Palestinian Liberation Organization and its Muslim backers attacked Israel and Christian villages in Lebanon. Eli joined the Israeli-supported SLA, South Lebanon Army.
I want to protect my family. I want to protect my identity as a Lebanese or as a Christian at that time, and the people of my country.
The Lebanese civil war took its toll, surrounding him with death and destruction.
You don't know if you will die today or tomorrow. So I start hating myself, not only hating my enemy. So I start drinking to forget. I didn't care about life. I didn't care about if I will die or live.
Eli's thinking changed quickly after his commander ordered him to disarm enemy rockets. That's when a landmine exploded beneath his feet.
I start thinking, I'm going to die. How can I face God right now? He's going to judge me. I was so afraid. Jesus, if you are alive, save me. I don't want to go to hell.
Eli's life was spared. He lost his left leg, but gained salvation. Called to ministry, he eventually joined Youth with a Mission and later attended Bible Seminary in Beirut. And it was right here in Beirut where Eli studied and he first preached that he learned that it was no longer safe for him to remain in Lebanon. So he packed up his family and he left the country of his birth and headed for America. He now serves as a nation's pastor at Milwaukee's Eastbrook Church, home to Christians from 60 countries.
Trying to equip the church, help the church understand more how to work cross-culturally, how to love people from different countries around.
Eli says God gave him a vision to do something bigger, to share his heart for the nations, not only with the people of Eastbrook Church, but with the entire Milwaukee community.
3, 2, 1.
Each year, he sponsors and participates in a charitable marathon race called Running for Hope. The idea came as Eli played soccer with his sons.
Why I don't run? Why I don't start an organization called Running, but for Hope.
Raising funds to ship containers of wheelchairs, crutches, walkers, and prosthetics to Lebanon and elsewhere in the Middle East. CBN News talked with some of this year's participants.
I run with Eli because he's so inspirational. He runs with one leg, and if I have two, I feel like I can help him out and help his cause. And it's called Running for Hope, and I feel like we give hope to a lot of people.
Eli tells his story in the book The Good Soldier. He hopes to return to Lebanon someday to personally deliver wheelchairs and other help. That's unlikely to happen as long as the militant Islamic group Hezbollah dominates the country.
I want to offer something for them. I want to share my story. Because these people need God more than any. Because we had war. These people are broken, suffering. They are still suffering. And there's a lot of hate, enmity, and people revenge. And we need God.
In the meantime, Eli says he'll continue the annual marathon. He also wants to encourage others to win life's spiritual race.
You have to have insurance and have this relationship with Christ in order to win the race. And I knew that in heaven, my leg will come back. And I can run and I can fly. I can enjoy this body. That's my hope.
Gary Lane, CBN News, Milwaukee.
Thanks, Gary. What a story of hope and victory, and he's an inspiration to all of us. Well, we've got another inspiration coming up for you.
Well, we were talking about the outrageous percentage of increase in obesity in the country, and I think our next guest has some answers. You see, he won $100,000 by losing 185 pounds. Pete Thomas shares how he keeps the weight off 7 years after The Biggest Loser.
He's here. You there, Dylan?
Freaking University is amazing.
You can't understand the university unless you visited and met the people.
I felt a sense of peace walking around the campus.
And I just said to myself, that's something I have to check out.
Your calling, your purpose, your future. Find your place at Regent University Preview. Call 800-373-5504 or visit www.regent.edu/preview.
Sorry for the delay, folks.
What did we do before cell phones?
Seriously, what did you do?
Two tin cans and some string.
I do like the security of having a cell phone, but I hate paying so much for the minutes I don't use.
Why don't you switch to Consumer Cellular? Their plan started just $10 a month.
Consumer Cellular is the wireless service designed to save money for people who aren't joined at the hip to their cell phones.
I have Consumer Cellular too, and what I like about it is that there's no contract, and I get discounts for being an AARP member.
Is it a prepaid phone like mine?
No, you get monthly billing.
Oh, and they send usage alerts.
So you can change plans anytime without penalties.
When you switch, you can keep your number and we'll activate your phone for free.
I'm going to call right now.
I thought you guys didn't like talking on the phone.
Money.
Plans as low as $10 a month with free activation and special discounts for AARP members.
Call Consumer Cellular TV at 1-800-621-6416. Go to consumercellulartv.com or visit a Sears store today.
Friday. As Greece burns, a new power rises.
The country's being lost.
One that may seem familiar to Eastern Europe. Plus, what these toys can teach you about building a business. And then, a live performance from Grammy winner Israel Houghton. Friday on the 700 Club.
Well, when Pete Thomas was a kid, food was hard to come by in his house. By the time he started bouncing around foster homes, Pete was wolfing down food whenever it was available. That was the beginning of a long struggle with his weight, one that didn't really end until Pete became a contestant on The Biggest Loser.
Pete Thomas weighed more than 400 pounds, had a 60-inch waist, and was 50% body fat when he landed a spot on The Biggest Loser. After 2.5 months, Pete was voted off. But that didn't stop him. Pete stuck to his plan and lost a total of 185 pounds, making him the most successful Biggest Loser of all time. In his book, Lose It Fast, Lose It Forever, Pete shares how you can throw out gimmick diets and frozen foods for the rest of your life.
Well, please welcome back to the 700 Club the author of Lose It Fast, Lose It Forever, Pete Thomas. It's great to have you with us.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
You were last here 60 years ago. Tell us what's gone on in your life.
Oh, well, in that time, of course, I have maintained the weight loss through diligent research and study and understanding not just the nutritional side, but the physical work that's required to lose the weight, and then even more importantly, you know, the spiritual side. I had to have certain goals in mind. I really had to believe that the Lord wanted me to be healthy for the rest of my life, and those things have been combined into the book.
And some of it is taking care of emotional business. You know, almost everybody I know that struggled with weight, whether they've been successful in losing it or not, acknowledges that food really isn't the issue. It's
right,
the
definitely issue
behind the food.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about your life growing up, because you came through some difficult things.
Absolutely. You know, my mother struggled with mental illness, and because of that, we were transient on the go from one city to another city to another. So, as you mentioned, I ate 2 and 3 times the amount of food that was required whenever it was available. And that carried that over into my adulthood. And then from there, I had to recognize, okay, if I'm going to keep the weight off, I've got to do certain things, and I call it mastering your mind. I had to set certain goals. You know, I couldn't look at myself as that fat person, for instance. You know, we know that scripture talks about as a man thinks, so is he. And so I had to change the way that I thought about myself, and really that came, I realized that the Lord can redeem us from anything. He can also redeem me from the weight, and that's what I try to share with others now.
Is it odd to you today when you look at, you know, there's a the picture of the you now here,
yes,
but behind it is the person that you were before. It doesn't even look like the same person. It's bizarre. I said to my husband last night, wow, is that two different people?
Right.
Is that weird to you to see yourself
before? It is not too weird. You know, what I really look at that is that's the redemptive power of Christ. We can have this horrible upbringing. We can really struggle with the way that we were, but God can redeem us. And that's kind of the hope, the message of hope that I put in there, as well as some practical things. So I look at that and I say, okay, there's an inner piggy in me trying to get out, you know, but I'm going to keep him at bay because of the principles that I put in the book.
How did you get to The Biggest Loser?
Yeah, oh, that was a story in and of itself. You know, I really believe that my purpose and destiny in life required me to be healthy. Now, I'm saying this when I'm over 400 pounds and have no way of knowing what's going to work. I tried different programs and different plans, and then I sent in a video, and I believe it was just in God's path that I would end up going on to the show. I took all of these before pictures really back in 2001 and 2002 before the show was ever around, because I said, I'm going to lose this weight. So here it is with the goal setting. I'm going to lose this weight and keep it off. And nobody's ever going to know that I was overweight. And who would have ever guessed that I would end up on The Biggest Loser and shedding the weight in front of millions?
Well, and that's a hard job. Yeah. I mean, I watch folks on that show, and I think, wow, that takes a tremendous commitment, a tremendous effort. At one point, you're off the show, but you hadn't lost everything that
Absolutely
you wanted to lose.
That's correct.
How did you, when you weren't before people holding you accountable, and when you weren't having somebody push you through the hard stuff, how did you go on and lose what you wanted to?
You know, the Bible says that two are better than one, and it says that they have a good reward for the, and when one falls, the other will pick them up. And I use those basic biblical principles. I got a team around me once I got home. You know, I made sure that people would meet me at the gym and people would hold me accountable with my nutritional plan. And I just did some of the same things that I had learned from the show and some things that I had learned from scriptural principles, and I began to apply them on a daily basis. Lost over 102 pounds on my own at home, and then of course, more importantly, having kept it off for 7 years. That's really that is really the testament of the work that's been put in, and the fact that I'm able to share that with others and help others to get the weight off. That's a bigger testament.
You know, for a lot of people that I know that have lost large amounts of weight, they yo-yo.
Yes,
you know,
they do.
You didn't do that.
No, you know, and part of it is we have so much information out there. The majority of the information that we hear are just tips. And I have this saying, tips are for kids. What we as adults need is we need strategies to keep the weight off forever. For instance, one of my main things that I teach is never, ever, ever start a diet or nutrition plan that you can't maintain for the rest of your life.
Wow.
And so if you think about that, that means you're not going to do the cookie diet. I'm not going to do this little diet that requires me to drink 1,000 shakes. I'm not going to do the Master Cleanse. I'm going to develop, and that's what the book is about, developing a personalized program that really will fit any situation.
Do you have a word for people? You know, you mentioned earlier that you had tried prior to this to lose weight. And it's, I mean, you almost build up like even more discouragement once you've had a failure in that. What do you say to people who've tried again and again?
Yeah.
How do you get them on the wagon that gets over the finish line?
Well, you know, I say there a couple of things. Motivation needs constant education. And so you really have to set about, I'm going to educate myself on basic nutrition. I'm going to educate myself on exercise in my situation. You know, I'm 6'5". I'm a male. My program, if I were to give you my program, wouldn't fit if you were, say, a wonderful housewife here in town. You know, and so what I try to do is I try to guide people through developing a personalized approach to their weight loss, and more importantly, their weight maintenance. And the book is called Lose It Fast, Lose It Forever. But 3/4 of the book is on what I call developing forever habits. You develop those forever habits, and then you apply them aggressively, and that'll allow you to keep the weight off forever.
Yeah. Did you see yourself the way you really were at the peak of your weight gain?
You know, I was always very positive. You know, and I saw myself as being very big. There was just so much, as I say, so much misinformation about, you know, what should I do and should I do this and do you, what
confusion
time of the day.
It's
so
yeah.
much confusion, so much misinformation out there that I tried everything and nothing stuck until I got some basics on The Biggest Loser and then began to study on my own and really research the psychology of change, the nutritional information and exercise science at home. Mm-hmm. That information really allowed me to keep the motivation going until after a while, just doing things became a habit.
You're a big guy.
Yes, ma'am.
So you can put some weight on before you really notice.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That you,
yes,
you've overdone it.
That's right.
So at what point did you say, wow, I've got a problem here?
Yeah, I said it all along. I can remember sitting in the men's Bible study at my church and saying, well, if I'm this weight when I'm 30 years old, I've got to do something about it. I was that weight at 30. But what do you do? You know, I went out and bought a treadmill. I spent $5,000 on exercise equipment, walked for 30 minutes a day for a month and a half, lost 10 pounds. It was frustrating because I weighed 400 pounds. And so the information is just so scattered. There's so much misinformation that the reason I say that I'm a different approach is, number one, I've been there. Number one, I'm keeping it off. And so the person that most of us should be listening to is someone who's walked the path that we've walked. And so that way you'll get the information that you need to be successful.
Tell me what you're doing today, because this has changed your life, not just in a physical form, but I mean your work.
Absolutely,
now is
it is. Which is another testimony in of itself. No, we don't have time for that, but I travel the country speaking to corporations to engage their employees, getting their employees active on their employer wellness programs. I speak to churches and try to motivate saints. You know, my real desire is to motivate saints, Christians, and to really live out their purpose. And you have to realize that your health is vitally important if you're going to be long term successful, if you're going to completely fulfill your destiny, you have to have your health in order. And so that's what we try to minister.
You talk about a 4-point health plan to get there from here. Just give us an overview of that.
It's your power, then your plan, pursuit, and your purpose. And so your power deals with the mental side of it. As I mentioned, you know, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So we have to engage the mind. If you don't have focus on your goals, if you don't know exactly what you're going to do, you're just going to go with every wind that comes along.
You need to be specific.
You need to be specific after that. And then after that, you need your plan. It has to be your plan, a plan that fits you in your individual life. That deals with managing your mouth. What is it exactly do you, how exactly do you work out? And then we talk about your pursuit. When it comes to your pursuit, once you know these other things, you can really apply it aggressively. And then when it comes to your purpose, we need to realize that we have unique purpose in Christ, each and every one of us. And you need to be healthy to fulfill that unique purpose, whether you're an executive mommy or whether you're an executive in a corporation. You have to be healthy to fulfill your God-given purpose.
But I think of how different your life would be right now had you not pursued this with gusto and passion in your own life. Yes. Well, it's for all of us. Pete, we want to thank you for all the wisdom that you share listening to those statistics on obesity this morning. Yes. It's obvious that this is something the whole country needs to know. The book is called Lose It Fast, Lose It Forever, but it's not one of those quick, easy fix books. It's really practical, and it will make a difference. It's available in stores nationwide. God bless
you.
Thank you
very much,
Terry.
Appreciate it. Thank
Good
you
to
for
see
having
you again.
Me.
Pat?
Thank you.
What an inspiration for everybody. This is an inspiration program, all one after the other. Well, coming up later, we're going to be answering questions from our inbox. Connie says, everyone keeps talking about a worldwide financial run. I already live paycheck to paycheck, so how can I be prepared? Stay tuned as we bring it on. Plus, we'll be praying for our country, so don't go away.
From CBN. Sometimes in life, we choose the wrong path.
Huh? This can't be the right way, Chris.
Joy, look, a cave.
You heard the rules. We're not supposed...
Rules were made to be broken. Come on.
But you can discover the way back.
Now we're lost.
Join the Superbook DVD Club and get Superbook's newest episode, The Ten Commandments, plus two copies to share with others, all for your gift of $25.
On the third day, the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai in the sight of all his people.
God said no carved images.
He gave us rules.
Rules were made to be broken.
With your continued support, you'll receive three copies of each new episode as they're available. Superbook DVD Club.
Forgive our sin and let us be your people.
It's an amazing way to build a strong spiritual foundation in the children you love. Superbook, The Ten Commandments, available now.
That check you get every month from a structured settlement as a result of a lawsuit or from an annuity may not be enough to pay for all the bills that are piling up. If you're having trouble making ends meet, it can feel like you're adrift in a sea of uncertainty. You might think you're sunk, but now there's help. Peachtree can turn your structured settlement or annuity into cash today. Cash you can use to pay off debt, avoid foreclosure, pay bills, get a new house, or buy a new car. Money does grow on trees. Call Peachtree to turn your future payments into immediate cash when you need it most. Wherever you need help, Peachtree is there for you. The money from your structured settlement or annuity is yours. You deserve to have it, and Peachtree can help you get it.
To find out more, call Peachtree today at 1-800-825-3129. That's 1-800-825-3129 or log on to settlementfunding.com.
Life doesn't wait. Why should you?
Welcome to Washington for this CBN News Break. Another Christian-owned business has filed a lawsuit against the contraceptive mandate tied to Obamacare. Tyndall House Publishers says providing pills that induce abortion would violate its religious values. The Alliance Defending Freedom filed the suit, calling it, quote, ridiculous and arbitrary for the government to decide the company isn't eligible for an exemption. The group says Bible publishers should be free to do business according to the book that they publish. A Christian legal group is trying to overturn California's new law banning therapy for teens struggling with gender confusion. Beginning January 1st, professional therapists can no longer tell anyone under the age of 18 that it's possible to change sexual orientation. The Pacific Justice Institute is challenging the law, naming a plaintiff who says he benefited from the reparative therapy, and a psychiatrist who's also a therapist and a church pastor in San Diego. The Institute says the law violates the First Amendment and equal protection rights. California is the only state to ban conversion therapy. Well, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Lighting is my specialty. Have you ever heard of a Leco? How about a Fresnel? These are just a couple of the lights that we use. We can change an entire scene by just pushing a button. I'll light up your light. We have hundreds of gels to choose from. We can add warmth and texture to the image. I love making people look good inside or out. We bounce light, we feel light, and sometimes we even silhouette. My name is Randy Reed, and I'm a lighting director, and I work at CBN.
When my baby Seyon was born, she had a very bad cleft lip and palate. My husband and I entrusted her to the Lord, but still, every time I tried to feed her, she would choke, and in the night, her face would turn purple. Then one day, we heard from a neighbor about CBN. CBN paid for her operation, and now you can see for yourself. This is Seyon.
These are the things you make possible when you partner with CBN. Thousands of people around the world begin new lives because you cared enough to give. To those of you who recently pledged to join the 700 Club, thank you. Your help will make a tremendous difference in so many lives. Please be sure to watch for this mailing and remember to send in your pledge, because when we all come together to help, miracles happen.
If you're taking pills for type 2 diabetes and you're still not getting the control you want, call now or visit controlispossible.com. You have a chance to help control your blood sugar for yourself and for those who depend on you most. With your free Chance at Control kit, you'll get facts about insulin and how it can lower blood sugar, a meal planning guide that makes sense of food labels, serving sizes, and shows how you can still enjoy the foods you love, an award-winning app to access nutritional information and fine restaurants, plus a blood sugar diary to help track your levels and progress. Don't put off calling. Find out more about adding insulin to your type 2 diabetes treatment for yourself and for them. Call now or visit controlispossible.com for your Chance at Control kit. It will give you better understanding on insulin and how it can lower blood sugar. Call now or visit controlispossible.com.
The Bible says, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sins, and I'll heal their land.
Join CBN's call to pray for America. through November 6th.
Well, Ronald Reagan once said, if we ever forget that we are one nation under God, then we'll be a nation gone under. So we here at the Christian Broadcasting Network have launched a Pray for America campaign, and we're going to be praying for our country all the way through Election Day. And we'd love to have you join in with us. Give us a call at 1-800-759-0700, our regular number, and tell the person on the other line that you want to pray too. And then your request will be added to the prayer flag that you see behind us. And so we want to share with you a couple that we have today. We have someone here, Pat, I have someone here who is asking for help for the homeless, for food, for shelter, for jobs. That's certainly needed. And someone else saying, my prayer for America is protection from harm caused by severe weather, another thing that's really made an impact.
We have about 119,000 people have said we'll be praying, so it's a great army of prayer.
Yes.
And it's spiritual revival in the church that our nation returned to our biblical foundation. Folks, I don't want to see us get to be like Greece or like Spain or any of these other countries that are going into deep depression and chaos. This is a great nation. Part of the world is in flames with bitter, bitter rancor. We need harmony, we need unity, and we need the power of God. And if we'll come back to the biblical foundations, we can achieve that because God will bless us if we obey Him. Now, Terry and I are going to join hands together. Please join with us for this moment because we're praying all the way through the election. Father,
thank you.
We call it to you for this great land. It was established by people who loved you, and it was a covenant that they made with you. We ask you to help us renew that covenant, forgive the sins of your people, and bring us to a place where we will be pleasing in your sight so that you would bless this land. God, we need a revival. Send a powerful revival to this nation, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Terry?
Well, coming up, we're going to be putting Pat on the spot. He's going to be answering your email questions. And then later, we'll hear how Operation Blessing wouldn't let a hurricane rain on one couple's wedding day. That's all next, so stay with us.
You're just thinking about one thing, the money and your selfish means and what you want. And when you're at that place, you're in a dangerous place. When I should have been killed in the streets, He didn't allow that to happen. He showed me mercy, even when I didn't deserve it. So when I realized how much God loved me, that compelled me to love Him back. It compelled me to love Him back.
I started feeling pain between my spine and my shoulder blade. There was a sizable mass consistent with malignant cancer. That's complex. That's tough stuff.
To find out more about our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans. Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity and the most well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
My strength came back. I began to become myself again. I'm so happy that I went to CTCA.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits.
Friday. As Greece burns, a new power rises.
The country's being lost.
One that may seem familiar to Eastern Europe. Plus, what these toys can teach you about building a business. And then, a live performance from Grammy winner Israel Houghton. Friday on the 700 Club.
Continuing this Thursday post-debate edition of the 700 Club. When Hurricane Isaac slammed into the Gulf Coast, it destroyed the home of Gloria and Collins Ackerman. But Operation Blessing was on the scene. And Operation Blessing helped them start a whole new life.
There weren't many memories left for Gloria and Collins Arsement. They lost their home when Hurricane Isaac hit Louisiana.
Some of the walls have caved in. The ceilings have fell in from the rain. A lot of mud and dirt. You have all that in the house. Everything in the house is saturated with filth.
Things were especially hard for Collins, who has stage 4 cancer. He wasn't able to make it to this interview because the mold and bacteria were a threat to his system.
He's not supposed to be around none of this. He came one day, he had to physically see it to believe it. I tell you what, we didn't know where to turn.
Gloria and Collins had big plans to renew their marriage vows. Then the hurricane hit. They had been married by a justice of the peace and wanted a church wedding. But the storm put their plans on hold indefinitely. When Hurricane Isaac hit, the Arsements grabbed what they could and evacuated. When Operation Blessing arrived to help them clean up, Collins had one request.
And I left our wedding ring sitting on a nightstand. And the only thing he asked that we get out of the house was our wedding ring.
Then the Operation Blessing crew began the work of helping the Arsements piece their life back together. We gutted their home so they could rebuild it. As the volunteers cleaned out the debris, they found the rings. Then Operation Blessing had another surprise for the couple. With help from many local businesses, we gave them a wedding to remember.
My favorite moment was hearing him say, "I do," again for the second time. Last night was more than I ever can dream of. The perfect wedding. I wanted something very simple, just my wedding blessed. That's all I ever wanted. And last night was like a fairy tale.
It's a blessing just to know Operation Blessing. And it's just heartwarming to know that there are people out there to do these kind of things.
So good that we can help them. And you know, they wanted such a simple thing, to reconfirm their vows, their love for each other. It's so beautiful.
Mm-hmm. You know, some of these storms and hurricanes, the things that happen, natural disasters, are so life interrupting. I mean, certainly life is lost in them, but the devastation of being left with a home like that is just beyond imagining.
We worked very much down in New Orleans after Katrina. We stayed there with Operation Blessing month after month after month, and I was in one of those houses that we were rehabbing, and I had a mask on as we were taking out that mold, but so help me, it didn't matter. I had one of those filter masks, but it didn't matter. That stuff gets to you, it gives you a headache.
I mean,
it's just, terribly sickening. So people, they can't live in it, and the people who are doing the work, it's very hard for them. But we'd gut those houses and take all the mold out and then put up drywall and all that, and they were habitable houses again. And we helped a number of them. I don't know how many, but it was quite a few, and the Arsements were one group. Well, we have some questions, and so I am sitting here on the hot seat.
You are on the hot seat.
All right.
Yeah, you ready?
Go.
Okay, this is from Connie, Pat, who says, "Everyone keeps talking about a worldwide financial ruin that could happen soon. I'm single and I live paycheck to paycheck. I don't have much in savings. How does someone in my situation prepare for this? I hear people talk about how to protect your property and money, but how do you prepare if you're already bad off now?"
Well, you shouldn't have gotten in this condition. You should have been saving along the way, and
that's such a hard thing for people to do when
their
money's tight.
Yeah, I know it's
tight.
Hard, but you just have to stop. I mean, they have to say there's certain things I can't afford, and I imagine I don't want to seem judgmental, but cable TV costs $40, $50, $60 a month. We've seen interviews of poor people living in the slums in New York who had cable TV, and they had several other things that were causing. And people have got to say, I maybe can't afford the car. Maybe I can't afford these other things. Of course, God wants people to have good things like this, and there's nothing wrong with it. But you're asking me how to get back in shape. Do not go into debt if you can possibly help it. Get out of debt. Pay off your debts as best you're able, or else have enough cash or reserves that you can take care of the debts if you have to. And then I really think gold or silver, but the Bible says the gold and silver cannot save you in the day of God's wrath. So there's really the biggest thing is to trust in the Lord and to begin giving to Him. But I do think to cut back on your spending to the point where you're ahead of the game. I mean, even how difficult that is initially, it'll be more easy as you get along the way. Start building up some kind of a small nest egg.
A little bit at a time.
But in order to do that, you may have to cut back on things that you think are absolutely necessary, but it's going to be difficult. But you can do it. And it'll happen faster than you realize. And then you begin to get ahead, but do not go out with some big purchases. Don't get yourself deeply in debt, because it's the heavily indebted people who are going to get hurt the most if there is some kind of a financial crash.
Okay, this is from Ian, who says, as a Christian, I've been doing my duty by giving at church, and like any American, I've been reporting those offerings on my taxes. But I wonder if that means that I am, quote, claiming my reward here. As Christians, shouldn't we be giving in secret? It feels like reporting is the wise thing to do, but keeping it secret is an act of faith. I want to do the right thing, so I'd like some advice on what I'm supposed to do here.
What you're supposed to do. The Bible, you know, it's not a book of rules. What it is it says whatever's not of faith is sin. I mean, if you feel it's wrong to claim deductions, then by all means, don't claim them. Okay. I think you should. I claim if the government makes it available, because that means you've got more money to give away and more money to use for important things.
When the Bible talks about the right hand not knowing what the left hand is doing, isn't it talking more about not bragging about the things that you're doing?
Of course it is. But still, it's, you know, you give in secret, and the Lord who sees in secret will reward you. But I think the fact that this is a means of getting additional income, which you can use to do worthwhile things, I wouldn't feel bad about taking authorized deductions from taxes. In other words, you are not paying taxes. You're not bragging about your giving. What you're doing is saying, I am doing this in lieu of paying taxes to the government to waste. All right.
This is Nick, who says, do you think it's possible for God to hold back or cancel a blessing? I know several preachers who went into the ministry because they say God was calling them to it. But after years of them being at it, they haven't seen God move in their church. Is it possible that God's not blessing their churches because of sin in their lives?
Listen, only God knows that. And I'm sure not the guy that can give you the answer to that one. Only God knows. But I would tell somebody about the ministry, if there's anything you can do that'll make you happy besides going into the ministry, don't go into the ministry.
Really?
Really? Unless there's
a
call.
Why do you say that?
Unless there's a call of God. Paul said, I am constrained. I have a call of God to do this. And if you do, then the difficult days, you just go through them. I mean, I had a call of God in relation to television. It was hellacious in those early days. It was difficult. It was thinking, I'm going to quit. I can't stand this. But God had a call. And if the call's there,
the call kept you during the
time. It kept me in it.
Yeah.
You know, difficult, but kept me in it. And then prosperity and blessing came. And it will come if you're in the will of God. But I don't know. I can't.
Only you can judge that,
yeah,
I guess.
And only, I can't say what's somebody's heart. I just can't do it. Well, that's all the time we've got for today's show. Tomorrow, a live performance from Israel Houghton. And today, we leave you with these words from the Psalms. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness to the skies. Bye-bye. Bye.
Friday. As Greece burns, a new power rises.
The country's being lost.
One that may seem familiar to Eastern Europe. Plus, what these toys can teach you about building a business. And then, a live performance from Grammy winner Israel Houghton. Friday on the 700 Club.
When my baby Seyon was born, she had a very bad cleft lip and palate. My husband and I entrusted her to the Lord, but still, every time I tried to feed her, she would choke, and in the night, her face would turn purple. Then one day, we heard from a neighbor about CBN. CBN paid for her operation, and now you can see for yourself. This is Seyan.
These are the things you make possible when you partner with CBN. Thousands of people around the world begin new lives because you cared enough to give. To those of you who recently pledged to join the 700 Club, thank you. Your help will make a tremendous difference in so many lives. Please be sure to watch for this mailing and remember to send in your pledge. Because when we all come together to help, miracles happen.